Welcome to a special edition of Anglican Unscripted, an interview with Archbishop Peter Jensen. I'm Kevin Coulson. Via the magic of technology we call Skype, across the ocean, across the hemisphere, I have Archbishop Peter Jensen from Sydney on, and we're going to talk a little bit about what to expect from Gafcon. First, how are you doing, Archbishop?
I'm doing really well, thanks, Kevin. Considering it's the morning, it is 9 o'clock in the morning, so I'm sort of okay. I'm a night person.
Every time I talk to David Ault, he wants to do it at night as well. It's like, this morning stuff is no fun. Let's get to some questions before, it is getting late here too, before all things get crazy. You're in Sydney, soon you'll be flying to Israel, into Jerusalem for Gafcon 3. I was at Gafcon 1 and 2, and I will be at 3. Tell me, what are some of the differences between the three of them?
Well, it's an evolving thing, I'm glad to say. Numbers first. The first Gafcon, I think the numbers were about 1,100. The second, 1,300. This time it's 2,000.
That's great.
There's a maturity to the movement now. I wouldn't speak of moments and movements. This is a movement. And there's a growing maturity to the movement. So it's bigger. It represents something like 50 countries, depending. Depending how you count, one or two of the countries is a little small, but nonetheless, about 50, as opposed to, I think it was 38 last time. There's, of course, I always think of Gafcon as a future conference. Mm-hmm. It's not, in a sense, looking back. This is the Anglican Communion having communion and getting ready for what God wants us to do in the future.
Which is interesting, because you started out as a movement in response to what was happening here in America, and you set forth to set a new province in America, making Gafcon 1 very successful, and Gafcon 2 was equally successful for its missions. What should the attendees expect at Gafcon 3?
Well, as I said, it's the Anglican Communion having communion. It's not just bishops. It's bishops, priests, deacons, lay people. Mm-hmm. It's all of us coming together, men and women. So the first thing they can expect is fellowship, or communion, another word for it. With one of the magic bits for me, and I think for you, about Gafcon, is meeting extraordinary people from all around the world. You can expect that again.
That's good.
Hearing people from the front that you would otherwise never have heard even of. And there they are, and you're hearing from them. I can remember some stunning material from the front, which has been just astonishing. And I think we can expect that again. My prayer is, though, let me put it this way. Gafcon is a spiritual movement. It's not in the end political. It's spiritual. And my great prayer going into Gafcon, and I invite everyone to share it, is may the Lord meet us in Jerusalem. May he be there amongst us. As we hear his word, may his spirit bless his word to our hearts, and may we rise up in praise and exaltation of the Lord and seek his direction for the future.
Amen.
May the Lord meet us in Jerusalem. Amen.
Amen. What was noticeable about the first Gafcon and the second one was Canterbury felt a need to respond in some way, whether by video or by appearance. I remember being in Nairobi and there's Archbishop Justin Welby. What's he doing here? Can we expect another message from Canterbury?
No, I don't think so. In a sense, we've moved on.
Mm-hmm.
We're talking about the past and the future here, in my opinion. We're talking about the old British Empire, and we're talking about the new world in which we live. And so, no, we're not expecting anything. I mean, we haven't heard of any move. What I observe, and I'm very sorry to say this, but what I observe in response to the Gafcon movement is a sort of spiritual fear, a fear which expresses itself. I'm now speaking about the many who talk about Gafcon. It expresses itself by demeaning us, or it's just a ginger group. really.
That was something, wasn't it?
Or speaking nastily about us, so that there's a phrase that's going around, toxic Gafcon. Toxic Gafcon, about a movement which is standing for orthodoxy and which is uniting Anglicans who have been dispossessed. How very strange this is. And so you get these demeaning phrases, you get these sort of, well, that's the way God works, I'm sorry.
Indeed.
He's doing it. It's his work.
Gafcon 3 will be notable for networks. You're putting together 9 separate networks to administer, help, embody Christ into the Anglican Communion, into Gafcon. Tell me a little bit about the networks.
Yes, Gafcon isn't going anywhere. It isn't, that is to say, it's not going away anywhere. 9 different networks on all sorts of important subjects, creating networks of Anglicans so that we can, between conferences, resource and help each other. The networks, for example, are in the training of bishops, which has proved to be tremendously successful. We've been doing it now for a couple of years. The networks are to do with theological education, with church planting, with mission, with aid and development. It's this sort of area, we're even getting a please don't tell anyone, but we're getting peers together to think together, which ought to be a lot of fun. I'm speaking, Kevin, as one who failed law as a teenager twice, so you can understand my feeling about this. But the lawyers are getting together. There's a guy called Phil Ashy and another man called Rob Tong, and they are producing, talking their business. And so 9 networks going ahead of people who have common interests, people who want to draw together, people who want to push. See, Kevin, the point is this. The Anglican Communion is so big and so widespread that, humanly speaking, as I look at it, I see it as a mighty, as potentially, well, it is, but potentially an even greater instrument in the hands of Almighty God to reach the lost world, the world of sin and death and judgment, with the saving knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. So our business is not to fight little political battles here and there everywhere, but our business is to unite Anglicans, grown-up Anglicans, future Anglicans, and to bring us together and to help us to resource each other on equal terms so that we can win the lost world. Hey, sounds good?
It does sound very good. Gafcon is not a organization that looks at the past. Tell me what Gafcon is going to be like in 10 years. How do you envision the evolution and growth of Gafcon? Because already Gafcon represents the majority of Anglicans in the world. By quite a bit.
Well, church-going Anglicans.
Yeah,
church-going
sure.
Anglicans, anyway. Yes, one of the things that we'll be doing, or one of the things, when I say we'll be doing, it does depend on the conference.
I am not
the conference. So one of the things that will be suggested at the conference is that we now develop some of the structures of Gafcon, not in a revolutionary way, but so far we have been a little bit too dependent upon the primates as such, and we've found that often the primates turn over, they change, and the continuity is a bit lost. We will still have the primates. The primates council will retain its power and its effectiveness, no doubt. But we are now creating further structures, calling upon people, laity, clergy, bishops, to support and to strengthen the movement going forward. In other words, it's becoming more of a movement, so that even if provinces come or go, or primates come or go, the movement will still go on. Mm-hmm. One of the things we've done, Kevin, is to start up branches in different places. So since the last Gafcon, I think I'm right in saying, not only do we have a branch in the UK, we now have a branch in Ireland, we have a branch in New Zealand, in Australia, and of course we have one in South Africa, but we will probably set up more of these branches around the world as well, to give expression to Anglicanism on the ground, which is where it really operates.
Well, now it seems that Gafcon is also sparking their own provinces. You know, Brazil being certainly one of the newer ones.
Yeah, of course. Well, again, this reflects reality. It's a spiritual movement. Mm-hmm. And, okay, the work in Brazil, we know the history of it. We know that the Recife diocese withdrew from a church which had gone down the wrong direction against Lambeth 1:10, more important, against the Bible, which is reflected in Lambeth 1:10. And the folks at Recife, with great courage, withdrew. They were supported by Gafcon. It's interesting that the old instruments of communion, as they called them, which is a funny name, but the instruments of communion did nothing. It was Gafcon, which kept the Anglicans still in the same boat. Now, as time's gone on, Recife has grown, and it's grown to the stage when they've created a province. Once more, Gafcon recognizes that province, as does the leadership in the Global South. Now, that's reality. And it's all very well to jump up and down in London and say, oh, they're not a real province, they didn't sign the right forms. I don't mind. ACNA is a province. It's recognized by most Anglicans around the world. And while, if I may say, sadly and delicately, if the official Anglican hierarchical structures continue to refuse to recognize reality, spiritual reality, well, it's just a further sign of their irrelevance. And so,
absolutely, yeah.
That'll be the test. Will they say, will they realize that the Anglican Church of North America, for example, and Recife, carries the truth, carries the reality of Anglicanism, has the title deeds, to change the metaphor? When are they going to realize and recognize the truth and spiritual truth? Because the longer that they refuse to do so, the longer they become, and it hurts me to say this, because who wants this?
I have to agree with you. I don't want to take up any much more of your time here, but this is the 21st century, and clearly the instruments of unity they're out of tune. And Gafcon seems to be working in a pretty good harmony right now.
And, hey, Kevin, I really like that. You've given us a new way of thinking of the metaphor. The instruments are musical instruments, are they? They're out of tune.
Out of tune.
I hadn't thought of that. Hey, listen, mate, before you brush me off like this, let me tell you a few things about the
letting you have a better day.
I am so looking forward to the whole meeting. Let me tell you, there's going to be 50 nations represented. There's going to be almost 2,000 people there.
Oh, wow.
There are going to be 75 people presenting in one way or another during the conference. Mm-hmm. We're having 24 seminars, for example. 75 people presenting, representing 23 different countries. Isn't that something?
Yes, it is.
And so it's the Anglican Communion having communion. Furthermore, I think that the conference is going to be, in a way that wasn't true at Nairobi and Jerusalem before, it's going to be pulsating on the front of communications and media. Mm-hmm. That is to say, people will be able to tune into this conference as never before. And furthermore, out of this conference is going to come a great stock of Anglican wisdom and theology, which will be there permanently for us to tap into. This is the biggest, I think I'm right in saying, it's the biggest Anglican gathering in 50 years.
I would say, yeah. you're bigger than Chicago Quadrilateral, bigger than Lamb. Yeah, I would say that you guys have the numbers.
And we've done it.
Yeah,
sure. We've had to raise hundreds of thousands of dollars to help people to get there who want to get there. And it's all come out of the pockets of Christian people who believe in this gathering of Anglicans. But the whole point of it is that the Anglican Communion, we're not leaving the Anglican Communion, it's the future conference. Mm-hmm. We want this movement to reform, to renew, the Anglican Communion so that we can reach the world which needs the Saviour, our dear Lord Jesus Christ. That's what we want.
All right, your closing was better than my closing. I really appreciate that. I look forward to seeing you next week. I'll be there Saturday, and shake your hands and get this Gafcon off to a good start. Thank you so much again.
Oh, babe, I may let you shake my hand, perhaps.
Perhaps.
No, I'm only joking. It'd be great to see you again.